This might be ridiculously short. We'll see how this how it goes today. But that's always entertaining. So today we're going to talk about estimation and bootstrapping some more. And to get started, we had some announcements from Graham. We also just, here's the upcoming status of Project 2. So don't forget about it. Another thing I wanted to point out is there's an organization on campus called BUDSA, which I think stands for BU Data Science Association. Aardvarks, I'm not sure. I don't know what the A stands for, but they are putting together this mini hackathon. It starts at 9 a.m. on Saturday and runs until 9 a.m. on Sunday. So it's 24 hours, and they can be a lot of fun. They are, as it says there, no experience is necessary, you know, so hopefully if you decided you wanted to go, you can go and kind of participate in a project. You get to build something, and usually if you kind of go alone, they'll kind of team you up with other people, maybe who are, you know, stronger in certain aspects than others, et cetera, so you can kind of make up a good team. There are prizes. However, as I have complained about hackathons at BU in the past, the entire point is the prizes. And they say TBD currently. So I know there will be prizes. That's why you go to do hackathons, aside from getting to build something for fun with a lot of support. There's a whole bunch of like mini workshops that you can learn, you know, various things. My TA for my other class is actually doing a presentation on Scikit-Learn, which is something like NumPy, except does other things. So, you know, there's a bunch of stuff like that all throughout the day. That's the QR code. It has a sign-up registration link. They can be a lot of fun. You know, they can be a big-time commitment. Usually, the way most people do these kinds of things, you actually, you'll be on a team, right? And if you really just need a break, your team can kind of continue, right? And then you go off for like an hour and go do something else for a bit. And then you kind of come back and somebody else swaps. So you don't have to be there the solid time. But it does make you, it tends to make you really punchy by the end. So it can actually be more fun because you haven't gotten enough sleep and everything else. So strongly recommend it. I will be there for at least part of it. You know, come by if you want. It should be fun. Any questions? Has anybody here done a hackathon before? All right, cool. There's a bunch of them that BU runs. The big one, this is actually being put on by BUDSA and teamed up with Boston Hacks, which is a really big one that is, I want to say, in the fall normally. And they do actually another one here too, which I totally blanked the name of, which is specifically targeted to people who identify as women. So that one's kind of crazy, 800, you know, yeah. Sheha. Is it? No, but that's the old name, right? What's the new name? Tech Together. Tech Together. That's it. Yeah, I think it used to be called SheHacks. But Tech Together, that's another big one. Lots of prizes, lots of good stuff. So highly recommend them. They're fun. All right. So talking about percentiles again. This is kind of talking about it from a different direction. This is actually a quote from the book. So theoretically, you've all read this already. But the pth percentile of a collection is the smallest value in the collection that is at least as large as the p percentage of all the values. So I just kind of wanted to give you a little more of a formal definition. This one actually kind of makes a lot of sense to me. So, you know, hopefully it does to you too. All right, so as an example, what is the 50th percentile of this array? And I think I forgot to make this harder, but I was going to rearrange the numbers. Anybody know? Yeah. He thinks it's 62. So it's basically right on 34. So that's the thing, right? So these are tricky, I think, because they kind of equal is on. But so the 51st percentile might be 62. But yeah, and then the other thing I want to point out is, right, is the median is 48. And so that doesn't appear in the set, right? So that's the middle of the numbers, which is not necessarily the middle number. All right, now we have questions. And I may have given some of them away. I also realized in retrospect, I probably could have just put in all of the answers or all of the values as answers, but it didn't occur to me at the time until I was all done and then didn't have time to fix it. Oh, just while we're waiting for this, sorry, I didn't put the lecture notebook in until the last minute. So it is there now, but it really literally has like two lines. So you might find it handy, but there's not a whole lot of notebooking today. So, all right, put your answers in last minute. And let's see what we got. All right. So 20th percentile is the number 22. I didn't realize how hard that was going to be to say out loud. So when you're doing something like the 20th percentile, like, are there any tricks that you can think of that you can kind of do in your head that make this simpler to figure out? You have an idea? Yeah, so that's pretty good. So, for some reason, I always remember that 20 is like a fifth of 100. There's another trick you can do that kind of quickly helps you solve these kinds of problems. Any other ideas? You can just kind of divide, right? So if you divide it and get one block, right, then you know kind of roughly how many blocks there are. So in this case, right, it's like 16.6. And so you know it's going to be the second one because it's above 16.6. So like the first percentile is at 16.6, if that makes sense. That's the way I think about it. Maybe it's helpful for me and me alone. All right, more questions. All right, so what is the 16th percentile? Close it there. Get those answers in. All right. And this one, I kind of just gave away the answer a minute ago, which I have a tendency to do. This is why I shouldn't talk so much. But yeah, so 16th percentile is 9 in this case, because it's just shy of the 0.6, right? So it's still within that 16th percentile. All right. Got another one. So what is the median of this set of numbers? Oh, it's everybody. All right, so as we talked about before, it kind of means the middle of the thing, right? Not necessarily something that is in the set, whereas with percentile, we mean something that's in the set. All right, only, I think there's two more, maybe? All right, what's the 51st percentile of this set of numbers? All right, get those answers in. Six left. Except some of them could be phantoms. All right, everybody's in. All right, so the correct answer was 62. And like I said before, I kind of gave it away. So this is basically just on the kind of far edge, right? So it just kind of just fell over on the other side. And that's why it's 62. All right, so this one I think is kind of completely different. All right, so this one I'm not sure if I said this quite correctly, but so if the 51st percentile is 62, then what's the highest percentile you can have before the answer is 77? So like, kind of like, what's the percentile that's like right here? Right? Does that make sense? I'm asking the question like this because I want you to kind of think of them almost like they're like little ranges, right, where one particular number from the array falls into it or the set. All right, I can tell you it's a whole number. So I'm just looking at the whole number. So technically, I guess there's an infinite spectrum after that, right? But I was just looking for the whole number. But it looks like some people were trying some decimals. All right, everybody happy with your answers? All right, let's call it there. Got a pretty wide spectrum. All right, so these are all the answers. But the correct answer was 66.
Okay, so 51st percentile is 62, then you can kind of go up from 51 to 66, and that's before you get to 77. So the correct answer for everything, the percentiles between 51 and 66 will be 62. That's what I kind of mean, is like almost think about it like a range. Make sense? All right, so this is the kind of thing that does tend to come up. So if you're not confident in how strong you are on the answers to these, like I think the book makes a lot of sense for this, so take a look at that. You know, it'll probably come up in homework and questions like that, and other times we'll bring it up, but just something to kind of keep in mind. All right, so the next thing we're going to talk about is estimation. So in some ways, estimation is a lot of what we care about here, right? Is like we want to be able to make estimates about unknown information. And so there's kind of a procedure to it. And it helps you figure out what techniques you can use depending on where you are in our handy flowchart here. Okay, so this is mildly confusing because I talked about the census earlier, but the word census with a lowercase c means the complete set, okay? So when we're taking a census in a country, we're trying to get a complete set of all the people who live in that country. Okay? That's why it's called a census. But in this sense, because it's the lowercase c, we just mean, do we have access to the entire population of the data? How often do you think that occurs? How many people raise their right hand if you think that occurs regularly, and raise your left hand if you think it's rare? hand for regularly and left hand for rare. All right, so I think most of you had your left hands up. It's always confusing looking out because it's the wrong hand. But yes, exactly. So we've talked about it a bunch of times. It's pretty unusual to have a data set that includes an entire population. You know, even like the country census, right, clearly is going to miss some percentage of people. And that's one of the things they also try to calculate is how many people did they miss. But if you do have access, you can calculate directly the parameter you're looking for. Okay. But if you don't, then you want to take a random sample, and then you try to determine a statistic that is an estimate. Right. And so what we talk about a statistic is a calculation. Right. It's not an actual like hard number. It's some kind of calculation. So like median or mean or, you know, those kinds of things, those are all statistics as they're calculated. Whereas a parameter would be something like, you know, height, okay? Like that's just a number. That make sense? All right. So, and then what we want to do is figure out the variability of that estimate. So when we do one sample, right, we take one estimate, but the random sample could have come out differently, and so the estimate could have been different. So the big question, right, is how different would it have been if we do it again? Okay. So we've seen a lot of examples of this. We've been doing this a bunch of times, like in the Jupyter notebooks, right? We've looped through it 1,000 times or 10,000 times or whatever, pulling independent samples so that we can kind of look at a whole mess of samples and then try to see if we can get it to kind of converge on the statistic we care about, right? That makes sense? Anybody remember what the law is that lets us do that? It's not the gambler's fallacy. All right, so that's the law of large numbers, right? So that's how we can get into doing these kinds of tricks. All right. So then we want to figure out, like, what, you know, we want to actually measure that uncertainty. And this is where we get into some of our, like, terminology or keywords or whatever. So the estimate is variable, so it can fluctuate, right? Because every time we pull a sample, the estimate is going to be slightly different, right? Likely. Then we have a parameter, which is fixed, and then we have an error, which is, like, for all intents and purposes, random, okay? So you can usually expect a certain spectrum for that error, but it's going to be random what exactly it is. So when we do the estimate, we take the parameter plus the error, and then the error is the estimate minus the parameter. And so what we want to do is figure out how accurate is the estimate usually, so like what's the diff on that error, right? And then how big is a typical error when we count census? We can do this by simulation. And so this was the, when we do things without replacement. All right, so when we want to understand the errors of our estimate, like, what do? Right, so we make more samples. I'll let you read that for a second while I drink. So, what we want to do when we don't have a ton of our sample or a ton of like examples, then what we want to do is we want to simulate random samples. And because we don't think we can go back to the population and actually gather more data. And so what are we going to do in that scenario? This is where we start talking about bootstrapping, which we covered a little bit last time. And so a bootstrap is a technique for simulating repeated random sampling. All that we have is the original sample, which is large and random. But this is the key, right? Therefore, it probably resembles the population. Okay, so it needs to be big enough that it has some similarity to the actual population. But but we don't feel like it's large enough to necessarily tell us what we want to know. It's not a complete census, right? And so what we can do is we can sample at random from that original sample to try to get to our estimates. And here's a question. All right, so what is a bootstrap? right. Get those answers in. All right, let's call it there. Oh, everybody, I think everyone's in. Almost everyone's in. All right. So a technique for simulating repeated random sampling. So I think I asked in this class last time, does anybody know what a bootstrap actually is, like a real bootstrap? I looked this up because I didn't actually know. Anybody have a pair of shoes, right, that has like a tag like on the back and you can pull it up? That's what the bootstrap is. It's on the back. You can use it to kind of pull on your shoe. I always assumed it was like a strap that went over your shoe, but it's not. It's just the thing on the back that lets you pull it onto your heel. So there you go, useless factoid of the day. All right, so why does the bootstrap work? Okay, so our population, right, this is our census. It's unknown. We don't know exactly what it looks like, but we do have a sample that we have collected somehow, right? And we think that that's a decent sample. We think it's representative of the population. But we're not sure how good it is. So obviously, what we wish we had, right, was the population itself. And then we pull a sample, and then we can sample without replacement to do our estimations based on the population, or based on the sample population. Okay, make sense? But when we are in this scenario where we don't know exactly what the population looks like, then what we can do is if we sample, we can sample with replacement, and we can maybe get close to what we're looking for, which is estimates based on of the population. Yeah.
So for sampling without replacement, is there a minimum size to the population?
So the question was, is there a minimum size of the, like, is there a minimum size to what this is or what that is?
Like, if you wanted to sample without replacement,
yeah.
Do you need a population of a certain size, or is it just?
So that is the question of the ages, right? Is that how do you know if this is big enough, essentially, right? Is that what you're kind of asking?
Effectively, yes.
Yeah, so that's very, very challenging. So what we do is we actually kind of calculate it in reverse, in that we try to calculate what are the chances that it's wrong. Right, or that it's not big enough, rather than kind of trying to say, like, it's not particularly easy to say, this is the correct size. Instead, we can kind of say, based on the size we chose, we have this much confidence that it's the right size. That makes sense?
So there's like a magic number of 137,000
people? Nope, not even close. Yeah, so that's one of the big challenges. All right. So, and the reason I was clarifying the question is because, as it says here, I think, maybe it's on the next slide, but the samples need to be the same size. Because what we're doing here, right, is when we're sampling in the bootstrap scenario, so if you remember, right, in the first scenario, we didn't want to throw off our distribution. That's why we would sample without replacement, so that we would end up with another sample that had the same distribution of the thing as the original, okay? Whereas in this scenario, what we want to do is we want to introduce some, you know, for lack of a better term, some chaos, because that's going to give us a more representative sample of the population. Does that make sense? And we'll see lots and lots of examples. So if it's not 100% clear yet, we'll get there. All right. So the idea, yeah. It depends on which one you're trying to, like, which path you're going down. So if you think your sample is, you know, near the size of the population, then you would do it. I always have to think about which way to say it. The without replacement. But if you think it's tiny, you know, in kind of comparison, right, then you would do it with replacement to essentially introduce error, right, or introduce, you know, like I said, for lack of a better term, chaos, but not in a negative sense, just as in making your population look more different. Okay, so the idea here is bootstrap world sampling is roughly equivalent to real world sampling, but it's not always true, but it can be reasonable if the sample is large enough, and we hope that the variability of the bootstrap estimate and the distribution of the bootstrap errors are similar to what's in the real world. Okay, and that's what we're trying to get to. Make sense? All right. Do bootstraps use random sampling? Not the kind you put on your shoe. All right, get those answers in. I hate standing around. All right, maybe there's still some ghosts. All right, yes, they certainly do. All right, so the key to resampling is from the original sample. We want to draw at random with replacement as many values as the original sample contained, and that's important. Essentially for the math to work, okay? So your new sample should be the same size as your original sample. Excuse me. Basically so that the two estimates are comparable, right? And you can imagine, right, if you had one sample that was, 300 and one that was, 45, the estimates are going to be a little bit wonky. All right, and then we have a very short demo, I think, of this. Maybe this is the right window. All right. One thing I wanted to show really quickly with the percentile stuff is just, I'm not sure if you are all aware of this, but you can do nice things like this.
So if you put a number of activities or whatever and separate them with a comma, it will print them all next to each other nicely.
So if you aren't sure, if you wanted to say type in, or you can have nothing happen because you clicked the wrong button. There we go, it's a little better.
SCC is very, very slow today. Hopefully we don't have too much stuff. I was not expecting this slow, however.
All right, well, I'll start talking about the next one while we load this one. Oh, okay. So
the nice thing is basically you can kind of get it to print a bunch of different things all at the same time. So if you're noodling around trying to find which percentile you actually mean, if you were trying to do does it go from 51 to 66 one, and you just wanted to type in all the numbers, you can just do that by just separating with commas. You can print kind of as many things as you want.
In fact, when I made the questions for that, that's exactly what I did. Well, not exactly, but similar. All right, so we're going to talk about babies again. Okay, and so you recognize this table. This is the one we talked about. We talk about maternal smokers. And we're going to just look at the maternal age as a histogram, right? Oh boy. Maybe. Okay, and so that's just, we know what the ages are of these mothers, sorry. And then what we can do is figure out the average age of one of the mothers
by just taking the mean of a particular column, right? And this will give us back an array, which we can feed to the mean. And then we'll just shove it into this variable called mean age. And so the average age is whatever, 27.2-ish.
Okay. But then when we want to start thinking about doing the bootstrapping, we kind of like do like we've been doing for lots of stuff, is we create a method that's going to kind of do one of our events. Okay. And so in this case, we're going to return the average of a sample of the maternal ages. Okay.
So, can anybody tell me why I don't need any parameters here? Anybody else? Selects everything and? Well, yes, because it's a sample, but the other thing we tend to pass the parameter to sample. Right, with replacement. So by default, sample will grab an exact same number of rows, okay? And by default, it will do it with replacement. So if we just call sample on the births table, we will end up with a same size births table that's been sampled with replacement.
And then, so now we have our method, and then we, sorry, let me just scroll, okay. So then we basically get a whole bunch of them, right? And hopefully this won't take that long. But the first thing we do is we create an array to kind of put them all in, all the means for this in. And then we're gonna say, okay, NP A range, assuming I type it right, that's too many R's. And we're gonna do that for 1,000 times. Because if we go back, oh, sorry, let me back up for just a second here. If we go back to this table, right?
1,200-ish, not quite, children born, right? So we know that is nowhere near the size of all of the population of children born in any particular year. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if that's not even enough for any particular day, right? Like there's a lot of babies being born. So we might believe that this is a representative sample of the population. So in a lot of ways, it looks like the general population, okay? Even if it's not complete. So that's why we're using this method, because it's a very small sample. And for whatever reason, it's difficult to get more of this data. You know, just collecting the information can be difficult or expensive. So that's why we're using the bootstrapping technique. I do have the right thing open. So we're going to do for 1,000 times, we're going to get a new average, maybe, by calling our newly created function, right? And then oh my goodness. Hopefully y'all are typing along just as slowly as I am. All right, so that's going to give us 1,000 samples, and the average ages of the mothers from those 1,000 samples.
And so, but this is where we start talking about, like, remember how we were talking about, like, p-values? So we want to look at the edges around here, so that we can get to some idea of our confidence.
Okay, so let's say we were doing a 5% confidence.
confidence, okay, or 5% p value.
That looks wrong, right? What do you think this number? Why do you think this number is 2.5 instead of 5? Go back there. Right. So you've got the left side, and you also have to do the right side. So that means you need 2.5 on both sides to get to 5, right?
So I know I stared at that the first time I saw it for a while, so I figure other people do too. 97.5. And then we're just going to print those both, except I'm going to use an actual print statement. And there it goes. Took some chunking because we're feeling very slow today, but you can imagine, right? Taking a sample of whatever it was, 1200. With replacement rate, so we're getting a table of 1,200, and we're calculating the mean, and we're doing that 999 more times, right? So we end up with this percentile of 26.93 and 27.58 are kind of our edges of our age range. Okay, but then what we want to do is we want to start to visualize that, because then it makes a lot more sense. However, this is a lot of typing, so I'm going to cut and paste it. Well, a lot of typing with potential for high amounts of error that are difficult to debug. So let me, yeah, I'll talk about it first.
Okay, so the first thing we do is we turn that array into a table, okay? So it's just not a very interesting table, but we take all those means and we turn it into a table. It just happens to only have one column. And then we create a histogram. But as I have kind of told you before, if you operate on this plots thing, okay, it's kind of related to that histogram. And so what we can do is we can plot a particular position so that we can kind of see some dots on our histogram. And it's not all fitting on the screen very well. But so this yellow line here is basically, it's using that left and right. So this is where our 95% of our means land. Okay, so 95% of the age samples that we got are in that yellow area, or gold. It calls it gold. I call it yellow. You can call it whatever you like. And then we get the blue one, which tells us this is the population, or the average age from our initial real sample, right? So kind of want to make sure that this blue dot is kind of is in the middle-ish, right, of our yellow bar. Because if this blue dot is over here, we probably have a bump somewhere, right? That makes sense? Because we expect this to fall somewhere in there. It's possible that it doesn't, right? It is theoretically possible that it's going to fall in that 5%, like 2.5 over here and 2.5 over there, but it's pretty unlikely, right? And then we just put a label on the actual graph
word. And then that's what that last thing does. So it can be kind of handy, and it kind of shows you
visually what those two numbers represent. It's going to be that yellow line.
And the reason we care about that yellow line, we'll talk about in a second. Because that was that for this guy. Switch windows. All right, and so that's when we start to talk about confidence intervals. And we're going to kind of briefly talk about this today, and then we'll talk about it with some more examples next time. But so the confidence interval, and this, like, I don't know about y'all, but I think some of the terminology here gets a little bit confusing. So hopefully we'll go over it enough that it makes sense. But so the confidence interval, parameter of fixed but unknown quantity associated with a population, and the estimate is a number which is
an approximation based on random sampling of the parameter, right? So this is what we want, right? And this is our best guess at it, okay? And so if our confidence interval is narrow, right, then it's more likely to be is, so if our window, so if that yellow bar that I showed you before, the narrower it is, right, that means that the smaller chance, like, that you're wrong, because the things that are in it, there's fewer of them. Make sense? And if it's bigger, then there could be more things in there. Right?
So what we want is that yellow bar basically to be as small as possible. Without, like, cheating. All right, so
we talked about a 95% confidence interval. So the interval or range of values, estimates of a parameter based on random sampling, the interval contains the parameter 95% of the time. 95% is called the confidence level, and could be any percent between 0 and 100, but a higher level means wider intervals.
So basically,
this last point is basically like, why we're using the word confidence, right, is because this is how confident we are in this process. Okay?
So this, I think, is a great slide. I really like this one a lot. So
imagine that we were doing, like, you know, these estimates over and over and over again, right? And we end up with all of these yellow bars. So each one of these is a sample, right? And when we are talking about a particular position or an estimate or whatever, most of the time this red line, the yellow line, is touching it, right? But sometimes it's not, right? It's the yellow line is, like, too far to the left, or the yellow line is too far to the right, right? And that's our 5% when we're wrong. It's because the yellow bar didn't land, or the red line didn't land on that yellow bar. Okay, so there should be, if you counted this up and did the math, right, 5% of these yellow bars should not hit the red line, but 95% should. Make sense?
I don't know. Hopefully it helps everyone else, but I think this one's great. Like, it really makes it make a lot more sense to me. Now I gotta remember what the words say. So each line is the confidence interval from a fresh sample from the population.
And so if we do a whole bunch of samples, but it's resamples of the original population. So that gives us our confidence interval by looking at, you know, is that yellow line crossing the red line?
So, as all of you probably have experienced, right, this might be near and dear, right?
So, the COVID-19 vaccine produced by Pfizer et al., basically, one of the things that's a little confusing about this vaccine, right, is that it doesn't necessarily actually help you not get COVID-19. It makes it so that when you get COVID-19, your symptoms aren't as severe. This is very good marketing on the Pfizer's part or whatever that made you think that you wouldn't get COVID-19. It may also impact that, but most of the studies are actually about your reaction to getting COVID-19. So, the efficacy of this vaccine, 95%, with a confidence level of 95% and a confidence interval of 90 to 97% or 90 whatever. So, and this is the crux of it, right? Is that the CDC and FDA, so the people who are doing the testing or validating the testing, are 95% sure that the median, okay, so only the median of the people who get the vaccine who are asymptomatic will fall between 90 and 97%. Okay, so when you kind of read it out, right, there's a lot of information packed in there that kind of almost feel like, you know, one of the problems that scientists have a lot when talking to the public is kind of giving so many caveats, which are accurate, but make it sound like it's not good, right? So this is, I think, one of the most great examples where, you know, you kind of gloss over the fact that, oh, wait, it's a huge amount of the time that somebody is going to be relatively asymptomatic or completely asymptomatic for this. A huge amount of the time. However, because it's got so many caveats built into it, it kind of sounds like it's lower, right? So people number is way less reliable, right? Because for all you know, this confidence level here, right, is 60%. So what does this 95% efficacy mean, right? That means that 60% of those yellow bars, right, did not hit the red line. So great, it's 95%, effective for this significantly smaller portion of the population. And we can't really say, like, it's not 60% of the population, right? It's 60% kind of luck. So
that's why it's interesting and useful stuff to know. Okay, and then,
you know, as we were talking about earlier, right, what we want to do is narrow that confidence interval. So what we can do is lower the confidence level, so we can just say, 60% is fine, right? Do not recommend. Or we can increase the original sample size. So if you get bigger samples, that's how we get to higher levels of confidence. And this goes back to your earlier question, is how do we know when the sample is big enough, is when we can credibly get to good confidence levels, right? And as we said, classes ago, north of 90%, right? What you normally want is like 95 or even 90, like 99%. And then you're kind of in the right ballpark for something that you can actually rely on. All right. So, here's the old way I used to do these questions a lot before Tata. So, using confidence intervals. So, by our calculation, an approximate 95% confidence interval for the average age of the mothers in the population is 26.9 to 27.6 years. So, raise your right hand if you think this statement is true, and raise your left hand if you think the statement is false. About 95% of the mothers in the population were between 26.9 years and 27.6 years. Right or left hands?
Sam. All right. And to be clear, I've read this exactly the way it's written, because if you don't kind of say the words exactly right, you can kind of make it wrong. All right. Right and left hands. Get them up. Let's see. All right, hold them up. Got to keep them up. But here should be the answer, with any luck. Yes. So
the answer is false. We're estimating that their average age is in this interval. Okay? So in other words, if you take any given person, they may not be in there. But the average of the sample will be in there. Does that make sense? Right? So this is one mother is, I'm not going to do the math right here, but one mother is 80 and one mother is 10, right? And you still average out correctly. You don't really, because I didn't math it, but you get the idea, right? Averages can be a little bit misleading.
But usually it works. All right, and here we have another one.
An approximate 95% confidence interval for the average age of the mothers in the population is 26.9, 27.6 years. There is a 95%, or there's a, sorry, zero, let me say it this way, 0.95 probability that the average age of mothers in the population is in the range of 26.9 to 27.6 years.
So let's see, true, raise your right hand, and false, raise your left hand. I couldn't remember what the opposite of true was for a minute there. All right, got to keep them up, though. All right, let's see them. Take your guesses. As you can see, you will not be penalized for incorrect answers. All right, so this answer is also false.
The average age of the mothers in the population is unknown, but it's a constant. It's not random, right? No chances involved, okay? So this is a little bit of a trick question, because it doesn't seem to be asking about the randomness, like that part of the question, but it's a constant. So you just gotta be careful of that terminology of that, it's not random because it is a real number. Does that make sense? Okay. So,
again, like I said, it's mostly about the terminology in that question. It is in the prior one, too, but this is one of the things about kind of this confidence interval stuff, is that your specific word choice matters a lot because it changes the meaning quite a bit. All right. So when do you not want to use the bootstrap? It's really silly. When not to use bootstrapping, right? If you're trying to estimate very high or very low percentiles, or a min and a max, right? And if you're trying to, let's see, I thought I had good examples, please, but So the second one I would say is really common. So we'll talk about this more in the future, but a rare element of the population, in other words, that's an outlier. So basically, it's like if you have a lot of outliers, then it can be really difficult to use this technique. It's when they affect it. So it's kind of like the mother who's 80 and the mother who's 10, right, is going to really screw up your average, right? And if the probability distribution of your stat is not roughly bell-shaped, and we're going to talk about this more probably next time, the shape of the empirical distribution will be a clue. So this is where, have you all seen that, you know, curve that kind of looks like a hump, right? We'll talk about standard deviation. But if it doesn't look kind of like a bell shape like that, this probably isn't going to work real well, okay? So if it's real choppy, like it shifts way over to the left, this in some ways is similar to the outlier example. Right? Because basically it means your data is kind of skewed. It's not uniform. And then if the original sample is very small, and to the question at the very beginning, how big is that? Very. Let's see. I think that might be it. All right. Any questions?